Thank you, guys. You know, the church of the Bible is a church that not only reaches right where you are, but also to the ends of the earth, right? And so a Christian church, a church that's got Jesus' name on it, needs to have that perspective all the time. And so since they're willing to go, we need to help them, right? And that's how we reach the ends of the earth, with those who are willing and called, and they go. And so, bless you, and thank you for doing that, and allowing us the privilege to serve alongside of you, partner with you. We're going to jump into God's Word, but before I do, I just want to let you know, for those who've never been here before, you're probably wondering where the music is, and there will be. We're just doing things different here. Right now, we're in this season right now where we just want to allow God's Word and what you experience here through the Scriptures, through a testimony like this, to let God work on you, okay? Just get into the nooks and crannies of who you are, and then we're going to have the opportunity to respond to that in worship, okay? So it's a little bit different than what you're used to, but we're Revolution Church, and we're a sudden and momentous shift in the status quo. There it is, all right? So all that to say, I'd like to read a scripture verse or two with you, and if you'd like to, and I would welcome you to do that, please open your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 12. There's lots of Bibles around. Don't just listen. Open up the Scriptures and put your eyes on God's Word, okay? So there's plenty of them. There's blue and white ones. If you don't own a Bible, please take that home with you, and that's our gift to you, okay? So when I start hearing the pages stop turning, I'm going to read. But I don't want to lose anybody. I don't want to leave anyone behind. I love the sound of that, by the way. That is good. That is good. Yeah. What's that? Hebrews chapter 12. Just the first couple of verses there. All right, sounds like the pages have stopped turning. So let me read this to you. Just context. The Lord is really just outlining for us all who would read chapter 11, these incredible men and women of faith. And so those are the ones that he's referring to here in chapter 12, where it says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses, these people of amazing faith that have lived in the past, okay? That's who it is. And this huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, now because of that, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up. And let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Father, I want to thank you for your word. And Lord, I know that I am not alone when I say that I believe with every stitch of me that if God's people were filled with God's Spirit, that they would abide and obey God's Word. And so I pray to that end right now, that you would do that, that you would fill us, every bit of us. Lord, you're good, and your mercy endures forever. And through this weak messenger tonight, you have a stern warning of love for your people. And I pray, Lord, that you'd give us all ears to hear it and give me the mouth to say it. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm not the same guy today that you're used to. And you'll know why as I begin to speak to you. I'm not unhappy. I'm not depressed at all. I'm certainly very, very blessed and happy to see what God is doing in your lives. many of you here I've known for a long time, and I've seen growth and progress and maturity in your walk with the Lord. I've seen a growing passion for the Word of God in you. I've seen you dig in greater levels of service and generosity. So in all measurable ways, it's just going well. And I'm blessed to be a part of your church. I'm blessed to see more people stepping in and helping. I'm blessed to see our Revolution band, really. It's been a struggle, man. You musicians are tough. You're hard to lock down, man. But I'm seeing a worship band come together that just loves the Lord and loves to sing His praises and loves to involve you in that. And I see this beauty coming out of this joint every single week, and it just blesses my heart. I'm excited about the fact that you guys are hungry for the Word of God. I'm excited that for the last like 8 months, I've been preaching through the Gospel of Luke, like one book, 8 months, and we've only been through like 10 chapters, and I've not heard one complaint about it. It's like you're hungry for the Word of God because you want to know who Jesus is, because you want to worship Him well. And I'm blessed to be a part of that church. I'm blessed to be a part of a church that when I'm an hour in, you're not saying stop. You're saying I want more of God's Word. Like, I love that. I love it. And I don't know that I could do that anywhere else. I was talking to another friend just a little bit ago today, and his pastor, a glorious, awesome man of God. You know, his sermon went 15 minutes over, and one of his old members, just a crotchety old man, oh, you better tell that guy he's over the limit. They need to tell that guy the door is over there. And if you're gonna come to the buffet table once a week, I'm gonna gorge you with God's Word. That's what I have to do. I got to answer to my King someday, and that's what I'm gonna do. And so I'm excited about that. I've been excited to preach through the Gospel of Luke big time, and I was really excited to do that this week too, but I'm not. You know, sermons or messages, whatever you want to call them, you know, we call them all kinds of stuff, whatever today's lingo is, you call it whatever you want, I don't care. But, you know, they're birthed out of different things. You know, this whole Gospel of Luke thing was birthed out of this foundational core belief of this church that we need to build this church on the truth of the rock who is Jesus Christ. And he said that to Peter. He said, "This is the church of the living God right here, right? I'm going to build my church. And who are you, Jesus? You're the Christ. You're the anointed one. You're the Son of the living God. And we need to know that God, because that's the God that builds His church. And I want to worship that God. I don't want to worship any other God." And so that's like bedrock for us. So I need to know the truth of who Jesus is. And so that's what we've been doing. And I love that. I love that. And that's where that was birthed from. But they sometimes messages or sermons, whatever, they're birthed out of something that's prevalent in our nation, maybe. See it on the news all the time, right? Sermons come out of that, right? Pressing things that are going on in our world. And so tonight, our message is birthed out of something different. You know, as a pastor, I know that you guys only think that I work on Saturday and Sunday, and you're entitled to that. But in being involved in people's lives in a deep way, listen, there's only so much carnage that you can lay your eyes to before you start searching for answers as to why. Why? And that's this week. So again, I'm not upset. I'm a little upset. I'm not mad. I'm not depressed. I'm saddened. My heart hurts. And I watch people that I love you guys. Like, we're living life out together. This is my family, right? And so when you get in relationship with your family and you love them, when there's pain and suffering in their life, it hurts you. And so there's only so much you can put your eyes on before, you know, that's what this is about tonight. And when I talk about like carnage, I'm talking about, you know, marriages being destroyed, churches being ripped apart, businesses failing at catastrophic levels. You know, addictions, like they fall off the wagon and there they are again in the ditch. And you're like, God, please help them. Financial devastation on and on in a family. It's just falling apart. And listen, all in the church. In the church. In the church of Jesus Christ. In the church, in the family of God that has the Holy Spirit of God living in it that raised Christ from the dead. That church. And it's like, what's wrong? What happened here? How did this happen? Let me tell you what happened. They forgot the Lord. That's what happened. They forgot the Lord. It's not, and I don't mean like they forgot, like, oh, there's a Jesus? No, it's not that. It's when you leave the house and you leave something there, what do you say? I forgot it at the house. And that's what I'm talking. People forget the Lord. They leave him at home. They leave him somewhere else, where not where they're at. Like, he's everywhere. I get that. Omnipresent God. I go to here, you're there. If I go to heaven, you're there. If I go to the ends of the earth or the depths of the earth, you're there. Like, where can I run from your spirit? Nowhere. I get it. He's everywhere. But you forget the Lord. He's not like arm in arm. He said, I'll never leave you, but you're leaving him all the time. And that's why marriages and families and businesses and churches are being devastated every single day. Where's the glory? The Bible says that in Christ all things are held together. So if that's true, why are things falling apart? Because you forgot the Lord. That's why. You forgot the Lord. If you're experiencing any type of carnage in your life right now, then somewhere along the line, you took a step in the wrong direction. You just took one little step in the wrong direction, and so your pursuit of the Lord has slowed down. Your serving of the Lord has lessened. You're spending less and less time with the Lord. Something like this happened. You took that step away from the Lord. And now you're experiencing, at that point, when that happens, the Lord starts to discipline his kids. Do you know this? Okay, God's kids are getting disciplined. And when I say discipline, that doesn't mean, kid, pick your switch. Most of us are parents in here. What's the first level of discipline you give your kid? Right here, right? Verbal. Hey, listen, kid. Don't do that. Right? Hey, listen up. Hey, don't do that. You say it, it's a verbal thing, right? So when I start talking about the discipline of the Lord, it's not like wham, wham, wham. It starts with a word. Like, you start messing up, and you're praying less, and you're serving less, and I don't see you here anymore, and you can see someone's life slipping, right? And one of you will say to that person, hey, man, and you give them a warning, right? Comes out of your mouth. That's the first step. And through the mouth of God's people comes the discipline of the Lord. And you say something to them, but they ignore it. They ignore it because when you're in sin, you have blinders on and you don't want to hear it. Did you ever try to talk to someone who's going through a divorce? You shouldn't do that. I don't care. Did you ever talk to someone who's an addict? You shouldn't do it. I know. This is obvious stuff. So you start getting disciplined and you ignore it. And I'm telling you, I'm preaching the truth right now, aren't I? Right? You all experience this a little bit. If you ignore that discipline, destruction is imminent. Every single time. And I'm telling you, I love you and I'm so tired of seeing it in our church. I'm over it. I'm so over it. And I want something different to happen here. You know, destruction comes in many forms, as I said, you know, a marriage, and it's now it's going through a divorce, or someone falls off the wagon. I'm talking massive destruction. I'm talking not like a bad day, not a bad week, I'm talking about some massive, massive, catastrophic thing that's going on in your life that's lasting and like you feel like you're bleeding out. Do you ever feel that? That's what I'm talking about. And this isn't just like a southern thing down here. It's not just an American thing either. It's not it at all. It's a Christian thing. It's a church thing. And it's not a new thing. It's an old thing. It's a repeating thing. It's a cat chasing its tail thing. And we need to break that now. Today. Today. What's the scripture say about salvation? I'm not talking about to heaven. Salvation is more than just to heaven. Salvation is getting you out of a mess you're in now. Delivered. Today is the day of salvation. If you're one of those guys or gals that feels the discipline of the Lord and someone's been telling you to get right, you need to get right and heed his word. You need to stop before you get destroyed. Destroyed. So we've been preaching through Luke, and we want to know the truth about who Jesus is, and we want to know what he taught and what he did and what he does and who you are and what he's going to do and all that. I get that, right? But as I said, circumstances this week have sent my heart searching for answers, and I didn't even know I was doing it. But I needed to know the answer, and I found the answer, and I'm not talking about like some surface level Oprah, Dr. Phil answer that says you need to communicate better and 10 steps to proper parenting and watch Dave Ramsey's, you know, financial piece. Like, those are all good things, but that's not the problem here. Those are symptoms. There's only one solution to the big problem. It's found in God's word, and I want to share it with you so that you can stop the destruction that's imminent in your life if we continue to disobey, okay? So here's the warning sign on the side of the highway as you're approaching this massive turn and there's a cliff. And here's God's warning sign for you, okay? It's Deuteronomy chapter 8. And I plead with you to go to turn there and put your eyes upon this whole chapter as I read it with you. We're going way back, way back. When you're kind of ready, just holler here. Ready, ready, ready? All right. I pray that God has your attention. This is your warning sign. This is God's love for you being displayed. Chapter 8 of Deuteronomy, it says, "Be careful to obey all the commands I am giving you today. Then you will live and multiply, and you will enter and occupy the land the Lord swore to give your ancestors. Remember how the Lord your God led you through the wilderness for these 40 years, humbling you and testing you to prove your character and to find out whether or not you would obey his commands? Yes, he humbled you by letting you go hungry and then feeding you with manna, a food previously unknown to you and your ancestors. He did this to teach you that people do not live by bread alone. Rather, we live by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. For all these 40 years, your clothing didn't wear out and your feet didn't blister or swell. Think about it. Just as a parent disciplines a child, the Lord your God disciplines you for your own good. So obey the commands of the Lord your God by walking in his ways and fearing him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land of flowing streams and pools of water with fountains and springs that gush out in the valleys and hills. It is a land of wheat and barley, of grapevines, fig trees, and pomegranates, of olive oil and honey. It is a land where food is plentiful and nothing is lacking. It is a land where iron is as common as stone and copper is abundant in the hills. When you have eaten your fill, be sure to praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. But this is the time to be careful. Beware that in your plenty you do not forget the Lord your God and disobey his commands, regulations, and decrees that I am giving you today. For when you have become full and prosperous,
and have built fine homes to live in, and when your flocks and herds have become very large and your silver and gold have multiplied along with everything else, be careful. Do not become proud at that time and forget the Lord your God, who rescued you from slavery in the land of Egypt. Do not forget that he led you through the great and terrifying wilderness with its poisonous snakes and scorpions, where it is so hot and dry. He gave you water from the rock. He fed you with manna in the wilderness, a food unknown to your ancestors. He did this to humble you and test you for your own good. He did all this so you would never say to yourself, I have achieved this wealth with my own strength and energy. Remember the Lord your God. He is the one who gives you the power to be successful in order to fulfill the covenant he confirmed to your ancestors with an oath. And now the scary part. But I assure you of this. If you ever forget the Lord your God and follow other gods, worshiping and bowing down to them, you will certainly be destroyed. And I need to stop here for a moment, because it's not like he's going to let them be destroyed. Listen to what he says. Just as the Lord has destroyed other nations in your path, you also will be destroyed if you refuse to obey the Lord your God. So much like Israel being delivered from slavery and evil in Egypt, out of the kingdom of darkness into this new place of promised peace and prosperity, this land of milk and honey, which is good, right? It's beautiful. And he delivered them from this place of evil and slavery to a place of peace and freedom. But the Christ follower, like if you're a Christ follower in here today, you can kind of say the same about yourself. You've been delivered, hopefully, right, from the kingdom of darkness and evil into the kingdom of light. And you're no longer a slave to the destiny of the unregenerate, the one who is not saved, the one who's destined for an eternity in hell because of your sin, right? You've been delivered from the power of sin to deliver you there, and you've been delivered from the power of sin to control your life and make you do stupid stuff. And so you've been delivered also from the evil, and you've been put into a place just like Israel was to these people, a place of peace and freedom. You've also been put in a place of peace with God and peace with eternity. You just say, it's all good. You can say it. It's so much fun to do that. It's relaxing, but you gotta like exhale when you do it, right? Let's inhale and then go, it's all good. Doesn't that feel good? That's the peace of God right there, right? That's good. And so, because of the life, death, and burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, you're delivered too, just like these people were. And so God says, hey, you got all this good stuff now. I've delivered you out of this evil and out of this slavery, and you're free from that. And so this is good. And so God provides a warning against the natural drift of all of his people right here. The natural drift of God's people is to do exactly what he warns us not to do. Be careful. When things go well for you, you might forget me. Don't do that. See, they enjoy the newness of life, and they feel free from their past mistakes, and they're no longer identified by the sin that they used to commit, but now they're a son or a daughter of the living God. They're not that same person they used to be. And so they enjoy that new life, and they come and they taste and see that the Lord is good, right? It's good, it's good. He says, remember how the Lord your God led you and fed you and freed you from all that? That's what he's talking about. Remember when I did all this stuff for you, this newness of life, and you came and you sat at my banquet table and you realized that it's better now, it's good now, now that you're part of the family. He says, remember Why the call by God to remember? Why does he do that? Because it's our natural tendency to forget. Andy and I, we're brothers. We joke around about it, but it's so not a laughing matter. And I'm just saying it, I'm feeling like major conviction. We joke because God has been so good to both of us. And yet the moment something bad, a speed bump comes into our life, I revert right back to being a Hebrew. It's funny, but it's awful. And God's talking to me. You forgot me. You forgot me. What about all those things? Remember? And I don't. And he doesn't. And we do it. We've been good friends for years, and it's still going on. It's getting better. Praise the Lord. It's getting better, but we haven't got there yet. You can pray for both of us. But we forget all the time. And I can't tell you how many marriages start out so good. They start out at the pulpit, and they're quoting the love verses from 1 Corinthians 13, and this woman is a treasure from the Lord. And this man is he's like the best dude ever. If I could be like the movie Weird Science and create a husband or a wife, this would be it. Thank you, Lord. And they're up there at the pulpit, and they have all this devotion to each other and to the Lord, and we're going to do this. And what God brought together, let no man separate. And then you look around. You're like, where have they been? And they forgot the Lord. And they're in the ditch. And their marriage is done. I got another one this week of people that I love that are awesome. And they got their eyes off the Lord again. And now their marriage is done. Why? Some of you know this. Can you picture things? You guys got a good imagination? You know what that is? What is it? A triangle. Who should be at the top? Jesus. So let's just say husband's here and wife is here. Eyes on the Lord, pursuing the Lord, going after the Lord. Can you just kind of tell me if they're going towards the Lord? What's happening to the two of them? They're getting closer. And what happens when one of them gets their eyes off the Lord? And that's exactly what happens time and time again, over and over and over again. They forget the Lord. Divorce, destruction. And listen, it takes two. One could have their face dead set on the Lord, but if the other one doesn't, this is what happens. Destruction is imminent. And I can't tell you how many times I've met in just in our ministry in these few years, how many addicts have come to the church and they've been chasing their tail, and the lies and the deceit of the alcohol and the drugs that promises them that they'll be happy, and they're sick and tired of that pain, and they finally come to the altar and they say, no more of this. Jesus is my Lord. No more do I need this. And they start hanging out here all the time and everything's going good. And pastor, I want to get baptized. I want to get saved. I want to serve. I want to do this. I want to do that. Everything's going great. And they come to their Bible studies and they're praying and they're texting me questions about the Bible. And then all of a sudden, guess what? Where have they been? They got their eyes off God again. They forgot the Lord. And listen, it's the same pattern. How long have I been doing this now? 12, 14 years, right? You're not unique. Do you understand this? I'm not here to rip you down or tell you that you're lesser than anyone, but you're not unique. If you forget the Lord, this is what's going to happen. And it's the same pattern week after week, month after month, year after year. And I'm telling you, I love you. And when you forget the Lord, destruction is imminent. It's what's going to happen. And even when it comes to salvation, just forget the drugs and the alcohol and the marriage, just salvation alone. The people come into the church and they hear a message and their tears are flowing and they feel convicted and they got the Holy Spirit hammering them and, like, man, preacher, you're reading my mail. I didn't read your mail. God's after you. And they're like, yeah, I'm so tired of the pattern of my life that promises this and never gets anywhere. And I don't want that thing anymore. And I want what you guys are talking about, because you guys seem like you got it going on here, and you're smiling and you love each other and you're hugging and you're having these potluck dinners and stuff. Like, what is all that all about? I want that. And so they come to the altar and they give their life to Jesus. And then all of a sudden, can you fill in the blank? Where have they been? Listen, I just got to set the record straight. I'm not telling you that going to church is going to save your marriage. I'm not telling you that going to church is going to save your salvation. I'm just telling you that's an indicator. If I could be rude, which I will not do, and I could list on the screens the families in this church that you guys know and love that are now divorced and in hell because of it, you would all know that they stopped coming, and you'd like, where have they been? Where have they been? They forgot the Lord. When the Lord is important, and your eye, Hebrews 12, 2, how do we get married? How do we die married? Right? Come on. Right? I've been down this destructive road of divorce. It sucks. And the kids are in hell because of it, because we didn't have our eyes on the Lord, right? How many families, I'm not talking about husbands and wives that come to church. How many, show of hands right now, how many families do you know where husband and wife both love, and I'm not talking about just coming to church, they love the Lord, and they worship the Lord, and they serve the Lord, and they love the Lord, and now they're divorced? When you forget the Lord and he's not the priority, crash. It's going to happen. And let's just turn the tide right here. Let's not do that anymore, right? Let's not crash anymore. Let's get our eyes on the Lord. He says to finish the race, right? To finish the race, you set your eyes on Jesus. And here's some insight. And keep them set on him. Yeah. The Bible, you know what it talks about? For all things, there's a season. It doesn't mean this. I just want to let you in on that secret. It's not like, well, I worship God for a little while, so we're good now. No. It's, hey, the lights are on, the air conditioning's running, God's like, I'm here, where are you at? Why aren't you here worshiping me? I'm here to receive your worship. I'm here to speak to you. I'm here to love you. I'm here to bless you. And where are you at? I showed up. Where are you at? That's what he's talking about. And listen, it's a season that never ends. It's a season that never ends. And we keep going. What happened to these people? What happened to these saints of God? What happened to these marriages? What happened to these people that put the needle down, that put the drink down? What happened to them? What happened is that they dipped their toe into the salvation pool instead of diving in, right, to the abiding fullness of a relationship with Jesus Christ for a lifetime. That's the difference. They came and they said, hey, hey, that feels nice. I got something today. My toe's tingling. Listen, he's looking for a whole body tingle for a lifetime. You got to dive in and start backstroking in that thing, man. Forever. Till you're wrinkly and pruned. And then he'll give you a new body. So you're good. So scriptures say in Jeremiah 29:13, it says, if you search for me with your whole heart, you'll find me. Like, if you open that Bible today and read that verse, that's what it's going to say. And guess what? If you open that Bible, that same one, next month and read that verse, guess what it's going to say? If you search me with your whole heart, you'll find me. And if you open it that day and you say, what's the day of salvation? What's it going to say? Today. And if you open it 6 months from now, 6 years from now, what's it going to say? Today. It's never ending. You got to keep going after him every single day. You never graduate. You never make it. You got to keep trying and trying and trying. And when you fall down, you pick him up and you go again. And when you fail, you just say, I'm sorry. He's giving you a gift. It's called repentance. I'm sorry, Lord. I didn't do it right. I treated her like crap. I'm sorry. I'm going to make it good now. And I'm going to serve her. I'm going to lay my life down for her. You know what? If she is wrong, be Jesus and take the blame. Take the nail for your wife. If he's wrong, submit to that stubborn, stupid man. And maybe God will honor that. Yeah. Just do it. Did you just say, oh, he's in the bathroom, yeah. I'll make sure he knows that's on YouTube. I was kidding. Every single day that you open the scriptures, it never, ever changes. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day I want to speak life into your marriage. Today is the day I want to deliver you from your addiction. You were delivered yesterday, but guess what? Tomorrow's coming, and today I want to deliver you from your addiction. Come to me. Don't forget me at home when you go to work. Come to me. Don't leave me at home when you go to the park or to the gym or to dinner. Take me with you. Don't forget me. He's the power to save. He saved you on that glorious day when you gave your life to him. And he has the same power right now to deliver you today, just like he did back then. Just as you came to Christ, the Bible says, so you must walk in him every single day. You came to that cross that day, and you were broken, and you were dirty, and you were guilty, and you were sad, and you were hopeless and helpless, and you crawled to the altar, and you said, Jesus, I can't do this by myself anymore. Please help me. And what did he do? He reached out his hand from heaven, and he picked you up, and he saved you. And you got to do the same thing every single day, because you ain't made it yet. You need him. Every single day, or else you crash. Isaiah 50, verse 7, Isaiah says this. He says, therefore I have set, pay attention. I have set my face like stone. I have set my face like stone, determined to do your will. Can you see the mountain? Can you see the rock? Do you see the Grand Canyon, that rock that year after year after year, you go back, and it never changes. And it still points in that same direction. And Isaiah says that about us. I have set my face like stone, determined to do your will. No matter what comes my way, I'm like a plow going down the center of the street. I'm coming after you, Lord, no matter what happens. I need you. I want you. You're all I need. Nothing else will do. And that's why God says in our text, remember what I did. Go down memory lane. Remember back to the deliverance. Remember back to the incredible opportunities that he's given you in life. Remember back to the times he prospered you or provided when you thought there was, you know, Lord, I don't know what to do in this. And he delivers. Think about all those times. Think about the blessings of your life. These are the best times of our life, and nothing else will do, right? But here's the problem. Most often, that's not the way it is. Most often, you don't respond that way, and I don't either. Most often, it's best described in God's Word. It's always the best way. In Revelation chapter 2, Jesus is talking to this church in Ephesus. It was a good church. They did lots of good things. They attended. And when the offering plate went around, they gave. And they bought Bibles for the missionaries in Mexico. They did all those things. Kinda. You know what I'm saying. But Jesus goes on and says, listen, but there's a problem. You did all that stuff. I get it. But here's the problem I have. You forgot your first love. You forgot me. You did all these things, but you didn't take me with you. And what did Moses say that makes us distinct amongst all other nations of the world? Isn't it that you go with us, Lord, that makes us distinct amongst all other people of the earth? And that's what he's saying. What makes you different is that the Lord goes with you. And he's with you in all things. Do not lean on your own understanding, but acknowledge the Lord in all that you do. And we don't do that. We don't do that. We forgot our first love. And when you do that, discipline ensues. And if you ignore it, destruction is imminent. And no one, listen, no one is outside of that. Nobody. Here's another common problem. And I think that in our text, verses 6 through 18, and listen, it might just be me feeling this, but when I read 6 through 18, I'm not going to reread it, but when I read 6 through 18, it really drives home a point for me that is crucial for us to understand, like massively crucial, okay? This is the problem that we all do this. This is so common, okay? Here's what it looks like. From 6 on, he's talking about, and just to give you a review, he's talking about the flowing streams, pools of water, fountains, springs, wheat, barley, all this awesome stuff that he gives, right? You remember that when we read it? So he's all this abundance, right? All this abundance. And here's what the problem is. So I have this great need in my life, right? I got a great need. My mortgage, I can't, listen, I can't pay it, right? I don't know what, my rent's due, right? I don't know what to do. Because I don't make that much and my rent's due and my car's broke down. Anyone ever been there? Like pick and choose, what are we supposed to do, right? My child is sick. My marriage is a wreck. I hate my job. I need another job. Whatever it is that you need, like we all have legit needs. There's time. Some things are wants. Don't try to shove them into the need column. You're not going to get it. But you have legit needs, all of us, right? And so I do as I should, right? See, in Philippians 4:6 says, don't worry about anything, but pray about everything, right? Thank God for what he's done and tell him what you need. Right? And that's what it says to do, right? The Bible, God wants you to pray, thank him, go down memory lane, remember all the stuff that he did, and then tell him some legit thing. Like, listen, Lord, my marriage is a wreck, and I need this. My job is terrible, and I need this. My finances are in the trash. I need this. Whatever it is, it's legit. He says, don't worry about anything. Pray about everything. Thank him for what he did, and tell him what you need. So that's good. He's telling you to do that. Okay? And so we also know in the scripture that if all of us who are rotten sinners can give good gifts, how much more so would your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask? So here we are. He says, ask him, tell him what you need, and he says, I'll give it to you if you ask me. So we got this good thing going on, right? And so God answers it, and he blesses you, and he answers your prayer, and he gives it to you. There's the warning sign. Be careful. Be careful. Don't forget me. And that's what happens. People pray to the Lord, Lord, and listen, you could be on the floor soaking the carpet with your tears, and he rushes to the brokenhearted, and he delivers you from that thing. And as soon as you get what you need from the Lord, all of a sudden, for some reason, he stops hearing your voice in his ears. Why? Who's guilty? Come on now. Confession in church. All of us. We forgot the Lord. We forget the Lord. That's a huge problem. It's a massive, massive problem. He says, don't become proud and forget the Lord. No, remember the Lord. In other words, take him with you wherever you go, in all things, at all times. But too many of us, too often, we pray and we ask the Lord, Lord, I need this, and he does it, and then you're like, silence. So to summarize Deuteronomy chapter 8 for you, I mean, it actually says it right in. I'm not even coming up with anything. What does he say here? He says, walk in his ways. He said, this is the way I want you to live. You're my people. Like, I don't know what everyone else is doing out there, but you're my people, and I have a way that I want you to live. Right? And he summarizes it for us in that. Just walk in his ways. Do as I say. What are the things that he wants us to do? I hammer him here all the time because we're still not getting it. He says, study to show yourself approved unto the Lord. Study God's word. Don't forget him. Don't think for a second that you're going to get a meal from me tonight and that's going to be sufficient. You wouldn't eat once a week, would you? But you'll eat the Bible once. 80% of Christians, Barna, 80% of Christians only read the Bible right here in church, and they're not even reading it. They're listening to it out of the mouth of another man. And you wonder. You wonder why things aren't going so well. When he's like, he's a giver of good gifts. Every good and perfect thing comes down from above. He loves you. He gave his own kid for you. So what do you think? He's not going to want to pay your mortgage? Do you think he doesn't want to help your relationships? Do you think he doesn't want you to have a good career that you love, that's fulfilling and has some purpose, and you can make a difference in this world? Of course he does. You wouldn't know him if he came up and said boo to you. Study to show yourself approved. Don't neglect gathering. Remember, the lights are on. The air conditioning's on. God's like, I'm here, where are you? Time and time again, I keep hammering this stuff. Listen, you know what it says in his word? I didn't have this, but this is what it says. It says that the Lord detests the prayers of those who don't keep his law. Now, he said in Hebrews chapter 10 to not neglect gathering together. And I stand up here and I'm telling you, God's church is anemic because you just simply will not even be a part of it. People will not engage in the work of the ministry because other things are more important to them. And he said, don't neglect to gather. And I say, you guys going to do that from now on? Yeah. And then next week, half of you won't be here because you're on a boat. And it's not Noah's. I'm just saying, quit forgetting the Lord. You know what I mean? Let's just be practical. Can I just put the Bible down a second? Let's get practical. Stop slacking. Amen. He wants good for you, and he's told you how to get it. If I gave you a treasure map with the X on it, would you throw it away? You'd follow it, wouldn't you? Well, I gave you one. I bought them, and I have them here for you. Jesus provided Bibles for you. It's your treasure map. Don't forget it. Stop forgetting the Lord. Stop forgetting the Lord. He said to pray without ceasing. Not just when you need something and then go silent. Pray about everything. All this stuff is all blessing and blessing and blessing, and God wants to bless his people, and he loves his people, and he wants to show off and be an awesome dad. How many dads are out there? Don't you like buying stuff for your kids, right? Come on, man. But when they're rotten, let's be honest. Do you really want to buy stuff for them? Heck no, dude. Of course not. I don't want to buy my kids anything if they're rotten. They're disrespecting their mother, throwing their crap all over the house, running into walls, breaking stuff. What, do you want to buy them more things to break? I don't want to do that. So why do you think that your heavenly Father just wants to pour out blessings on you when you're rotten? Come on, right? Let's just be practical. Don't judge me. Amen. Right?
Amen.
Come on. Y'all think that you can just do whatever you want. Don't worry, my daddy's going to take care of it. He'll strip you right out of that inheritance so fast it'll make your head spin. Hello. Talk to the nation of Israel. They were in. And because their unbelief, they forgot the Lord. He ripped them right out of that tree. Yep. Don't get cocky now. Right? Come on, right? Don't get cocky. You know, there's something else I just want to touch on real quick. Talking about forgetting the Lord. There's something at the heart of Almighty God for the poor. I mean, there's something heavy about, it's weighing his heart down with the poor. He loves the world, right? He loves everybody. He loves you. He really, really loves the poor, man. The poor. You bless the poor, you get blessed. You curse the poor, you better watch out, man. He's got a heart for them. Could I give you a couple of verses just so you know what I'm talking about? I'm going to read them. Okay? Proverbs 14:31. Let me see if I can find that. Proverbs 14:31. I'm just going to bear with me. 14:31 says, those who oppress the poor insult their maker, but helping the poor honors him. Right? That's a big one. How about Proverbs 19:17? Just going to kind of go through these real quick. 19:17. If you help the poor, you are lending to the Lord and he will repay you. Dude, I would love to have the Lord in my pocket. I'm just saying, right? Come on, right? Let's step away from the Bible so I don't get hit by lightning. I want the Lord in my pocket. Amen. That'll be rocking, right? Amen. You could owe me some money. That'd be cool. But if the Lord owed me a little bit of something, I'd be really thrilled. I'm just going to say. I don't even know. You'll probably never come back, but that's just the truth. It'll be great. You got any money? No, but the Lord's got me. That'd be good. Proverbs 21:13. How about this one? Here's another one. You ready for it? Those who shut their ears to the cries of the poor will be ignored in their own time of need. Yeah, don't ooh me. Listen, do something about it. There's a lot of oohs in the church, right? There's a lot of oohs and ahs in the church. Like, make sure you're here next week. Ooh, yeah, right. Listen, this is talking about you going to your knees and asking the Lord for something. And he's telling you, if you ignore the cries of the poor, he's ignoring your cry. And you could get on that carpet and cry till the carpet is so wet, it felt like it got out of the pool. And he's not listening to a word you're saying because you didn't heed to the call of the poor. You know what his answer to the poor is across this world? Not to supernaturally grow orange trees. It's that you would grow orange trees and bring them something to eat. His plan to reach the world with its needs is you that have, and his plan to reach those who need the gospel are those who already have it. You're his only plan. That's it, right here. No pressure. But that's the plan. He wants to reach the world. Here's the last one for the poor. 22:9. Blessed are those who are generous because they feed the poor. Mary works for Deliver the Difference. And like Manny and Wilma, they go to the ends of the earth when we won't. So we help them, right? If you won't feed the poor, Mary will. And she works for an organization that does just that. So if you want to help her and what they do and heed this call, see her before you leave. They'll accept donations. They'll accept help to go pack food and they'll accept help to go drive it to the schools and backpacks to kids who parents won't feed them food. Even though they're on food stamps, they'll neglect the kids, sell their food stamps for drugs, and the kids go hungry. Mary feeds them. So maybe you could just help out with that, right? I mean, I'm just saying, don't forget the Lord here, right? It's all right here. This is just the short list. Study to show yourself approved. Pray. Attend, participate, give, help. It's a short list of the continuing activities of the godly. This is what Christians do. This is who Christians are. Do you understand? You know, Christians are not spiritual snowbirds. Do you understand? We're living in snowbird country. We're not snowbirds spiritually that we're, you know, for 6 months we're on it. We'll go to church during this time and we'll give during this time, you know, maybe, oh, our tax return's coming. So we'll actually have some money. Now we'll give something. Well, that's awesome. And we'll use it for the good. But what about the other, you know, 51 weeks of the year when our offering plate's so bare we can't even help someone who comes to the door who's hungry? I'm being practical with you guys. I'm just telling you, this is what it is, right? You want to be a church that rocks the universe? Heed his word and do what it says. And watch the eyes of the Lord go back and forth across the earth, looking to strengthen those whose hearts are completely his. And he will bless this church if you're completely his. If you will obey what he says, he will bless this church and we will reach the world with the gospel. Proverbs 10:6 says that the godly, these are the people that are Christians, these are the ones who are doing this on an ongoing basis, says that the godly are showered with blessings. Anyone? I'm in. I want to be godly. I want blessing. I want the windows of heaven to pour out on me and my family. I want the windows of heaven to gush down blessing on this church and on this community. Desperately, that's what I want. I've wanted that from the moment I got saved, that God would show up and this whole area would be completely changed. And someone would drive through this community and go, what is going on here? They would feel something weird when they drove through. The Jesus bumps would be jumping all over their body. That's what I want to see. I don't know about you, but that's what I want to see. I want all the churches that get up and unashamedly preach God's word and love the Lord Jesus. I want those churches packed with thousands of people, and they're worshiping the Lord, and they're serving the Lord, and they're sharing the gospel, sending out missionaries, planting new churches all over the place. That's what I want to do. I don't want to just live my life and ho-hum and whatever average. No. The godly are showered with blessings. Just pour down on me, man. Stand under a waterfall. That's what it's supposed to be like. Not just a little sprinkle. Listen, God doesn't sprinkle. He immerses. That's what he wants. He wants to bless the people. That's just who he is. So look back at verse 6 of our text. Obey the commands, right? Walk in his ways. We talked. I think you might not like some of the, like, if I'm challenging you to do things you don't want to do, you might not like me, and I don't care. But I do hope that you've at least got some clarity on what is being said here, right? Are you guys clear? Because if not, let's just hang out right there afterwards, and I'll make it as clear as I can make it. I hope I've done that, but if not, I'll try. But so walk in his ways, we got that, right? I think that's clear. But how about this part right here? So obey the commands of the Lord your God by walking in his ways and fearing him. Yes. And fearing him. See, nobody wants to talk about that. Nobody wants to talk about fearing the Lord because it's the New Testament now. And God has his slippers on. Last I checked, God is the same. Help me out. Yesterday, today, that's right. Now, he may have his slippers on because he's leisure, because nothing stresses him, and he's in command of the universe, and he's not worried about it. That's when you know someone's got it good. You know the retired guys that walk around in their slippers even when they're at the store? Because they're just chilling, right? They're not wearing work boots anymore. They go to the store in their slippers. That's the Lord. That's our Father. He's in his slippers all the time. Look at verse 19 and 20. Talk about, he says to fear the Lord. I assure you this, if you ever forget the Lord your God and follow other gods, like, that doesn't mean a totem pole. That doesn't mean a carved little Buddha. Anything that you easily and abundantly and quickly throw all your resources at that thing, that's a god. And if you bow to that, he's talking to you. And he says, I assure you of this, if you ever do that, if you ever bow down to that thing, you will certainly be destroyed. You better fear him. You better fear him. He is the God who spoke and planets came out of his mouth. He is the God who spoke and the Red Sea opened. He is the God who spoke and Ananias and Sapphira fell flat on their face dead because they lied to him. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He has that power. He may not exercise that power, but you get next to a God with that kind of power, you better cower before him. You go swimming in the water in a steel cage and a great white shark comes by. You might be in that cage, but you better fear that thing, won't you? You might be on a safari in a truck with a roll cage on it, but if the king of the jungle comes walking by, you see Mufasa going by your truck, you're going to fear him, won't you? You'll go sticking your hand out, go, little lion, right? No, you're going to fear him because he has the power to snap your neck and kill you right then and there. And you need to fear that kind of strength. And let me tell you something. For all those people that are going to say, well, that's just reverence. That's reverence. No, it's not. No, it's not. See, the word for fear here, there's lots of fears in the Bible, but this fear is phobeo. You know, we get the word phobia. right? If you're scared of spiders, do you have reverence for the spider? If you're scared of a snake, do you have reverence for the snake? No, you run. Snake! Right? Come on, that's what a phobia is, right? The word phobeo is not just reverence. It has four definitions. Reverence. In awe of. Exceedingly afraid. And fear. So they chose to translate it as fear, but don't just say that it's reverence. No, fear is one of the definitions of this word. It's not fear that's defined as reverence. This word is fear. This word is exceedingly afraid of. This word is in awe of this power. It's all four of them, and how dare anybody take three of them out and say, no, it's just reverence. Who are you to think that? Who are you to say that? You're going to change God's word? Good luck to you, buddy. You need to fear the Lord. Fear the Lord. See, a lot of people don't like to talk about the fear of the Lord. Doesn't fill churches too much. But let me tell you something. There's probably some deep theology in Luke 12:5. But in Luke 12:5, out of the mouth of Jesus Christ, in red, so if you got a red Bible, you see it like it's Jesus. He says, don't fear men who could just kill you, but fear God who has the power to kill you and put you in hell. Fear God. Now, listen, you could do what you want, but you got to do something with that, right? You can't just ignore it and go, oh, that's just reverence. Reverence doesn't have the power to kill you and put you in hell. Now, will he do that? That's your choice right now. You make that choice. But he has the power to do it. And you just need to be so afraid and so thankful that he's not exercising his power right now. He is a God of mercy. And if we were to go before the judge and give an account for the crimes and the rebellion of our life, he would exercise that power and you'd be straight to the pit of hell. But he sent his son to take that penalty for you. Rejoice. That's awesome news. That's awesome news. Don't forget that, Lord. Don't forget that, Lord. So there's the warning. Be careful. How do we run this race that God set us on with endurance? How do we get to the end? It says to strip off the weights that slow us down. What are the things that are getting in the way of you remembering the Lord? Is it your schedule? Is it your budget? Is it your wife? Is it your husband? Is it your kids? Is it the church? Is it politics? What is it? Right. There's things that get in the way. What keeps you from studying? What keeps you from praying? What keeps you from attending? What keeps you from serving? What's keeping you from giving? What all these things that he says, this is what I want you to do. What's keeping you from doing that? He says, especially strip off the sin that's not just slows us down, because those things can slow us down. Those things that I just listed, they're all good things, right? Family, and all, those are good things, but they get in the way. But there's some things that absolutely stop and drop you. Nasty things. Sinful things that are in the way, and you need to get them out of your life. It's time to do some internal inventory and keep our eyes on Jesus. Keep our face set like stone. Listen, keep knocking, keep asking, keep seeking. Just as you came to the Lord, so continue in him. Same thing. First day, 10,000th day. Same thing. Determine. Listen, you got to make a decision. You got to determine whether you're going to be in position to be showered with the blessings of God by walking in his ways and fearing him, or you're going to be disciplined, and if you ignore it, you're going to destruction. It's imminent. There's no stopping it. It's going to happen if you forget the Lord. And we've all probably experienced all three of these things. His blessing, his discipline, and some destruction in our lives. We've all experienced it. And so God is so merciful. Listen, this is what I'm done right here. God is so merciful that he actually gives you, the power to decide what you're going to get. You can determine your future right now. You're either in position to have to be showered with blessing, or you're going to be bent over the couch, taking a whooping, and if you don't listen, you're going to destruction. Do you understand? Have I made myself completely clear?
Yes.
Does anyone in the room, being honest now, is there anyone in the room that is insulted by what I've told you? If so, I want to talk to you. No, I'm serious. I really want to talk to you. I don't want you to walk out of here insulted or feeling shame that you haven't done enough or whatever. That's not what this is all about. Because it doesn't matter what you've done, okay? It doesn't matter what you did to the moment you walked into this room. It starts now.
Amen.
It starts fresh. Clean start right now. And listen, if you have you been faking your Christianity for a long time? Listen, I've baptized worship leaders and pastors' wives. I baptized my own wife who was a Christian for 30 years and wasn't. There's no shame in the game. If you have been faking this thing and you haven't been walking in his ways and you haven't been fearing him and you haven't been serving him and you have had this phony, fake facade veneer of a relationship with God and you want to stop that right now and make a change, you can get saved right now and start a new relationship right now. Right now, you could just simply say a prayer and it's just going to come from your heart that you don't want that anymore. I don't want that anymore. Now I want you. I want the real thing. I want you. I don't want religion. I want a relationship with you. I want to serve you. I want to love you. I want to study your word. I want to share your word with the world. I want to be different. I want to be different. I don't want this anymore. I'm sick and tired of my own life. And the pain of staying here is far greater than the pain of changing. I want to change right now. If you want to do that, please, I'm begging you, today is the day of salvation. Say yes, finally. Give in and let's pray. Let's just talk to the Lord together and let's pray. And here's the good news. Remember I said it doesn't matter what you did up to this moment? It says in the Gospel of John that Jesus by no means will drive away anyone who turns to him. Doesn't matter if you were on death row last week for killing someone, you can be saved right now if it's genuine from your heart. He will not turn you away. You understand? So let's pray. And listen, if you want to start fresh, the Bible says we're supposed to be baptized, right? Does everyone know that? Be baptized? It never says you can't be more than once. It never says you can be more than 100 times. It never says anything. It says be baptized. If you feel as though you haven't had a real relationship with the Lord and you want to start fresh and start really fresh right now, that tank's warm and I'll be honored and blessed to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit right now. Enter you into the family of God, hopefully for all eternity if you meant it from your heart. But I don't know that. Only God does. But if you want those two things, it's available right now. The windows of heaven are open. He's ready to shower his blessing on you. And if you want that, please, I'm going to be standing right there. If you want that, you come see me. All right? Now I'm going to pray real quick and then we're going to watch something. And then listen. Show of hands. Honestly. Who heard from God tonight? Okay. They take you to the mat on some stuff, right? Now's your chance to say sorry. Now's your chance to be encouraged. Now's your chance to tell him how awesome he is. We're going to watch a short video, and then we're going to worship the King who's so worthy, man. You're going to get out your seat and stand to your feet and scream to the Lord and worship him. He's worthy of that, right? This is the Super Bowl of worship right now. Okay, so I just want to pray with you real quick, then we're going to watch this. Lord, I just thank you so much for your word. I thank you, Lord, for being so kind that you are clear with us. I thank you, Lord, for the warning sign that you've put on the road in front of us, Lord. All of us have entered into our relationship with you and with others and into marriage and into, like I said, sobriety and in our church relationship. All these different things in life, we've entered into them with good intention. But we have failed so often in so many of them. And Lord, so we confess now that we've We've not acknowledged you in all things. We've not remembered you. We've left you. We've left you at home. And it's your heart's desire to be with us and bless us. Your word tells us the godly are showered with blessing. That's who you are. Lord, we want that, and we've not received that to the degree that you want to give it. But as of tonight, Lord, we declare to you right now, we make a declaration of faith, Lord. We want that. That is what we want, Lord. We want to be showered with your blessings. Lord, I pray that you would help us all to do just like your word says, to walk in your ways. And you've been clear with us tonight what that looks like. So help us to do that. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.